So let me just recall in 5 minutes what as I said in the two previous lectures. So I'm going to be considering discrete subgroups in PSL n plus 1 C. And discrete. Then we define the notion of limit set, which we call the Kulkarni limit set, which when n equals 1 coincides with the usual definition, is just the set of accumulation points of the orbits. In the general case, you have to add to that set something else so that to ensure that the action on the complement is properly discontinuous. So in that case, you take the set of accumulation points of all orbits, then you take you look at the complement of that set, and you look at compact sets in that complement, and you look at the points where compact sets accumulate. And the union of all of that is the Kulkarni limit set that we've been looking at. So, okay? And so the first day, we spoke basically about the classical case, n equals 1. Yesterday, I gave families of examples, mostly in dimension 3, and yet they extend to higher dimensions, in which, in many cases, this was a very, very good concept. What I mentioned at the end, I gave examples of this, what we call a type of Schottky groups in CPN, for n auth, for which this is not always a minimal, there are examples in which this contains a proper closed invariant subset where such that the action in the complement is properly discontinuous. Okay, so in higher dimensions, it's clear that to have a good understanding of the situation, we need to do something else. We have to look at more refined things, and Adolfo Guillot and Mayra Mendes, they have good things in that direction. I'm sure for next meeting, we'll be able to say something. Okay? I mean, there are already good results in that sense, but so far in higher dimensions, it's kind of an experimental science. So, okay, so we are coming. So now I want to focus on the case n equals 2. Yes, so I want to look at automorphisms, holomorphic automorphisms of CP2. So that will be my focus today. And my claim is that in that dimension, this is the good concept of limit set. Okay. Let me start with some examples. The first one, we already saw it. Consider a matrix lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, 0, 0, with lambda 1 greater than lambda 2, greater than lambda 3, greater than 0. We have three one-dimensional eigenspaces in C3. When we pass to the quotient, we have three fixed points that we denote E1, E2, E3. These are the fixed points. And this is an exercise to show, well, one is attractive, and the other is a saddle point. The other one is repelling. And it's an exercise to show that this is the set of fixed point of accumulation points of the, these are the fixed points, and these are the accumulation points of orbits of points in CP2. Okay, and then in that case, we have three invariant lines: E1, E2, E3, and the Kulkarni limit set is the union of these two. Okay. Which one of these is attracting, and the other one is repelling. So we call those the, the one which is attractive is repelling for the inverse, okay? So we call this the repelling invariant lines of this, which is a loxodromic element. I said that in dimension 3, we called an element loxodromic if it has a lifting which is diagonalizable or not, with at least one eigenvalue of norm non-equal to 1. So this is a loxodromic element, and this loxodromic element has two invariant lines in its limit set. One is repelling, the other is attracting. Another example, consider now lambda to the minus 2, 0, 0, lambda. Okay, so now we have two distinct eigenvalues. Yeah, different to one. Yeah. Okay, now we have two distinct eigenvalues, and we have one invariant line corresponding to this block, and one fixed point corresponding to this block. In this case, the Kulkarni limit set will consist of one line, E2, E1, and one point. Okay, so I said that for loxodromic elements, the limit set was going to be the union of two projective subspaces of CP2. This is an example. Here we have two lines. Here we have one line and one point. Another example. Consider 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay? In this case, one can check that 1 is non-diagonalizable and 1 is the only eigenvalue. We have one fixed point. E1 is a fixed point. And we have one invariant line, but it's not an eigenspace. Okay? So in this case, the limit set is just the line E1, E2. Okay? So here we have examples where the limit set is one line and one point, two lines. Now, for example, now take one of these groups, take this one, I mean, the group generated by this matrix, and now take the group, for example, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, as before, and add one generator, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, sorry, 1, 0, 0. This matrix permutes the invariant lines. So when you take the two generators, now you get a group with exactly three lines as limit set, and three lines in general position. Each two of them meet at one point, and no three of them meet at the same point. Okay? So in this case, we have a limit set with three lines. What?
So that one just swaps.
Exactly, exactly.
Two lines, yeah. So you still could, I can't see,
yeah.
You have to get E1, E3.
Yeah, but now E1 is here, and the other one is here. I mean, the big eigenvalue, the big eigenvalues. Yeah, I mean, this is if you do it carefully, you get the three lines as limit set. Now, okay. You want maybe with this example? Okay. Now. Okay, now let me give you two more families of examples that have come in previous lectures. So now consider gamma Fuchsian group in H2R, sorry, in isometries, orientation preserving isometries of H2R, and such that its limit set is the whole circle, so a lattice in the group of isometries, either co-compact or co-finite. And think of it as a subgroup of PU11. So we are actually thinking of this as a complex hyperbolic one-dimensional space. Okay? Then you have a natural embedding into PU21, as John explained us yesterday. And this is naturally a subgroup of PSL3 C. Okay? So you have this group acting on CP2 in a natural way. So you have CP2. Inside you have a round ball, which is serves as model for hyperbolic two-dimensional complex space. And then the group, since it is a subgroup here, acts on CP2, preserving this ball. Okay? But because of how it is constructed, it is also preserving a complex line. A copy of CP1, whose intersection with this ball is a copy of the complex one-dimensional hyperbolic space. Okay? Now, in this case, we have the, say, Chern-Greenberg limit set, which is going to be exactly, because of this, the limit set is going to be this circle. The intersection of this line with the boundary sphere. Okay? And now I told you that when you have a subgroup of PU21, the Kulkarni limit set is the union of all projective lines tangent to the three sphere at points in the Chern-Greenberg limit set. So to get this guy, to get lambda cool, we look at each point in this circle, and we look at the unique projective line tangent to S3 at the given point. Okay, so we have one projective line for each point in the circle. And in this case, it's very easy to describe which are those projective lines. L is a line in CP1. We have a projective duality. We have some point outside, the polar point of the line. And then for each point in this circle, we take the unique projective line joining these two. Okay, so we have a family of projective lines parameterized by this circle and all passing through the given point. Okay, so in this case, we have infinitely many lines in the limit set, but all of them meet at one point. So we can say that there are exactly two in general position. Two in general position, a set of lines in CP2 is in general position, and not three of them meet at a point. Okay, so we have here infinitely many, two in general position. Let me say that in that case, it's also, you have a very nice clean description of the complement, the region of this, the Kulkarni region of discontinuity, which is, which one? Take one point in the complement. Okay, through that point, this point together with this determine a unique projective line. Okay, so you look at the projective line given by these two. The drawing is not very good because the line is going out of the space, but this is not. Okay, now that projective line meets this projective line in exactly one point. Two lines in CP2 meet at one point. Okay, and that point has to be away from this circle. So you get a projection from the complement of the limit set into this projective line minus the circle. You can easily check that that's actually a holomorphic bundle with fiber C and base S2 minus a circle. So topologically, you have two copies of R4. Okay, so in this case, the Kulkarni region of discontinuity consists of two copies of R4, or two open four balls. Now let me consider the same setting up to here. But now gamma, now consider gamma in SO21. Okay? And this naturally lives in SU2 2, 1, which can be projected to P, U, 2, 1. Okay? So we can look at this group here that also John explained it to us yesterday. And actually what I will say now is part of a joint work with John Parker and Angel Cano, which should appear soon in the Asian Journal of Mathematics. Okay? And so just look at this setting. We have now this Fuchsian group, cofinite or co-compact Fuchsian group, regarded as a group of automorphisms in CP2. Again, it's preserving, well, this is in PSL3C. So again, it's acting on CP2, preserving the complex hyperbolic space, which is a ball. So we have more or less the same picture. Okay, so this hyperbolic two space, complex hyperbolic two space, this is CP2. But now, because of how the group is lying here, it is preserving the points in CP2, which can be represented by real coordinates. Okay, that's a Lagrangian two-dimensional plane in CP2. Okay, so we have a similar drawing. But now this is a copy, which is a copy of RP2. It's a real projective space, which is being preserved by the action. So the action is preserving a ball and a real projective space. The intersection now is a two-dimensional disk, which serves as model for real hyperbolic two space. Now it's a different model. Now it's the Beltrami model. It's a copy of R2. Okay. Now again, the limit set, the Chern-Greenberg limit set, is going to be again a circle. Actually, now it's a circle, but to be correct, it's a copy of RP1, which is homeomorphic to S1. Okay. It's a, we have this disk, and if we look at this projective space R minus the disk, this is a Möbius band. Okay, so the complement in this projective reproductive space of this disk is a Möbius band. Now again, the Kulkarni limit set is going to be the union of all lines, projective lines, tangent to S3 at points in this circle. So far it's just exactly as before. But now this set looks very different, very, very different. Now one can show that if you consider two such lines, any two projective lines in CP2 meet at exactly one point. Okay? Well, that point is a point in this Möbius band. Okay? So any two lines here meet in exactly one point in this Möbius band. And through each point in this Möbius band, there pass exactly two such lines. Okay? So what you have now is that this set consists of infinitely many lines parameterized by the circle, but now all of them are in general position. Two of them meet at one point, and not three of them meet at any point. Okay? The meeting points of every pair of lines is parameterized by this Möbius band. Okay? And then in this case, it's not at all trivial, but one can show that the complement now consists of three copies of the four-dimensional disk. Okay, one can find explicit projections, and one can control the topology of the fibers and everything. It's very, very beautiful, I think. Okay, so in this case, the complement has three components. In that case, it has two components. Now we have infinitely many lines in general position. Here we have infinitely many lines, but only two in general position. Okay? So I remind you that in the classical, in dimension, complex dimension one, the limit set consists of one point, two points, or infinitely many points. The equivalent statement now in dimension two is the following theorem, which is essentially due to Barrera, Cano, and Navarrete. This one. The limit set, I mean, not everything is in one paper, and some pi statements are due to one, others are due to the other, others are due to the three of them. So I just put everything together. The set lambda cool always contains at least one projective line. And this statement is actually true in all dimensions, greater or equal to 2. That's something that Kahn and myself proved. 2, it can consist of 1, 2, or it can have or contain 1, 2, 3, or infinitely many lines. So if it has more than 3 lines, it has infinitely many lines. 3, it can have 1, 2, 3, 4, or infinitely many lines in general position. Okay, so I gave you there an example where you have infinitely many lines, but only 2 in general position. You can construct examples in which you can have exactly 3 lines in general position, infinitely many lines, but only 3 in general position, or examples in which you have exactly 4 lines in general position, infinitely many lines in general. Okay? 4, if it has isolated points, then there is exactly one such point. So there's an isolated point, there's at most one, and if that happens, then the limit set consists of one point and one line, and the group is virtually cyclic. Okay, so we have this theorem. And here I'd like to make a remark. What about the discontinuity region, the number of components in the discontinuity region? Okay. So, remark. In dimension, in complex dimension 1, the region is can be or can have 0, 1, 2, or infinitely many connected components. So it can be empty or can be connected to components or infinitely many components. In dimension 2, this can be can have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, let me put it this way. We have examples, there exist examples with 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, or infinitely many components. But we don't know if that's a theorem or we just, there are more possibilities. Okay? So I already gave you, it's easy to construct examples with 0, 1, 2, and 3 components. This is not so easy, but this also is known, it's something that these guys did. And, yes, please. You are asking me if that can happen?
So the, what's the cosine topology like after
you? Here, in this example? In this example, the region of discontinuity is a bundle over C, let me say, over a disk. So the, topologically, that is just a product. And then when you take the quotient, what you get is a disk bundle over the Riemann surface that you have as quotient of the disk divided by the action of the Fuchsian group. Yes, the same in the other case. So in that case, you have three components. Each has this type. Of course, the bundles are not the same. Yes. Yes. No, no, but the dual action is also on CP2.
Yes.
Okay, so it's not the classical limit set. It's again, you're asking, I think on CP2.
Yes, but since you have the limit set made of lines,
yeah. The dual is point. Yeah, there are very interesting relations, and for many of the results, they have done, you have to look at the dual space to get information. They are not exactly the same, it's different things, but they give information each of the other one. Yeah. In fact, in the last theorem I'm going to state, I will say something about that. Okay. So may I now recall that, in dimension two, in dimension one, we have that the limit set is many things. It has many nice properties. It's the largest set where the action is properly discontinuous. It is also the complement. CP1 minus the limit set. Sorry, it is the region of equicontinuity. And lambda is the closure of set of fixed points of loxodromic elements. And one more property. Let me assume, sorry. And G non-elementary. So this has cardinality greater than 2. And one more point. And lambda is minimal. All orbits are dense, and it has many, many more properties, but let me state this. Then we have a theorem. Again, by Barrera, Cano, Navarrete, and myself. If lambda q has at least 3 lines in general position, then well, let me put this in the memory 1 minute. Let me, before this, let me just recall this example I gave. Lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, 0, 0, with the distinct norms. You remember, it has lambda q has two lines in general position. And so we have this lambda 1, E1, E2, E3. So the limit set consists of these two lines. And in this case, one has that there exists not a largest set where action is properly discontinuous. There are rather two maximal such sets, because if you take this line union this point, the action on the complement is properly discontinuous. And if you take this line union this point also, and those two are maximal regions, but none of them is the largest. Okay? So there is not one largest region where the action is properly discontinuous. And in that case, the region of equicontinuity coincides with the Kulkarni limit, region of discontinuity, and is CP2 minus the two lines. Okay? So there are two maximal regions. No, there is not one largest, and none of them coincides with the equicontinuity region. Then the theorem is going to say that this is somehow the only possibility. I mean, you can have infinitely many lines, but the only possibility is that you have only two lines in general position. It's the only possibility to have troubles. So the theorem says that if you have at least three lines in general position, then everything is fine. Okay? Then there exists a largest region where the action is properly discontinuous, and this is the complement to this coincides with the equicontinuity region. And three, and this was two, three, lambda q is the closure of the set of repulsive invariant lines of loxodromic elements. Okay, and to mimic this, I would like to state this, but this is we need one more condition, and even so, this statement is weaker, but I think it's nice. Let me say it. And four, if G, the group, is called strongly irreducible, which means that there exists no invariant, no projective subspaces with finite orbit, irreducible. Yeah. Okay. So there are no periodic points, and there are no lines that, after a finite number of times, return to the line. Okay. Now, a comment which is not obvious is that this is not an additional hypothesis. This is a stronger hypothesis. This, if you have this, you automatically have this condition. Okay? Then if you have that, then the group acts minimally on the dual of the limit set. Okay? So the action on the lines can be non-minimal. So but if you consider the lines, then the orbit of each line is dense in the limit set. Okay? Now this is the proof has. Yes. Listen. Let me go by stages. This and this was already proved by these three guys. Yeah, and that's already published. And the idea is first you prove this. And this is, in fact, more or less trivial using, this is not more or less, this is an obvious consequence of the Cartan-Montel theorem in this dimension, which, Montel's theorem tells you that if you have a family in CP1 minus 3 points, the family is normal. In higher dimensions, you have the theorem in CP2 that if you have a limit set which, if you have a region, a family on a region, which omits at least 5 lines in general position, then it is normal. Okay? And that was improved up to having 3 lines. If you have 3 lines in general position, if you avoid 3 lines in general position, you have a normal family. Okay? Then you get this for free. Okay? Now, then you prove that the action here is properly discontinuous. And you also prove that this region is maximal. You cannot get equicontinuity going into the limit set. Okay? So putting all of that together, you get the first two statements.
I'm just slightly now confused.
Yes. Well, there is a, it depends on the hypothesis you need. Yeah. The nice thing, I mean, a big difference is that here we are removing projective subspaces. That's very a very nice picture. Okay. He has a much more complicated life in this sense. I mean, it's more, yeah, that's it's much harder to control. Okay. Okay, now the hardest part or the new part is this, to express it as the closure of invariant lines, repulsive invariant lines of loxodromic elements. For that, the proof is very long and somehow technical, and it has several stages. First step is obvious, is to just to notice that all these groups have finite index subgroups with no elliptic elements. And elliptic elements make no difference for the limit set, so you can forget about elliptic elements. Now, second step, look at parabolic, look at purely parabolic groups. So elements whose elements are all parabolic elements. And then after some work, you can show that limit set consists of either one line or let's say a cone of projective lines parametrized by S1 with one common vertex. So it is the limit set is as in one of the examples I gave you before, in which you have one circle, one point away, and for each point in the circle you have one projective line. So you have infinitely many lines, but only two of them in general position. Okay? So if you have this hypothesis, you cannot have a purely parabolic group. Then you must have loxodromic elements. And then there are three cases where the number of lines, let me denote it by this in general position, is 3, 4, or greater than 5. Okay, I told you that the number of lines in the limit set can be in general position can be 3, or can be 1, 2, 3, 4, or infinitely many. Okay? So in this case, these two cases are special in the sense that they have to be done independently by hand. Okay? And in both cases, one has to do the classification of such groups. Okay? So the classifications of four groups with exactly four lines, the classification of groups with exactly four lines in general position was done by these three guys and is already published. The case with three lines is new. And then using those classifications, you go case by case, and you see that the statements are true. And then the last case is the most interesting somehow. And there the idea is, is the obvious one, that to show that there are so many loxodromic lines that if you have a neighborhood, if you have a point in the limit set and a neighborhood, there's always a loxodromic line passing through through that neighborhood. So you can approach every point in the limit set by an invariant line, repulsive invariant line of an oxodromic element. But this, you have to do quite a lot of work. And I think I should stop here. I have a few minutes, but...